Okay, and now we continue with nklmish.
Okay. Okay, so do you hear me? Okay. Okay, so let's get started. I hope each and every one of you must have heard about microservices. Is there anyone in the room who haven't heard this word? Okay, one person. So I hope when you will leave this presentation, you will know. And right now you have heard about microservices. Okay, so jokes apart. Let me ask you a simple question. How many of you have developed your own microservices? Okay, so I hope when you will leave after this talk, you will know how to write and develop your own simple microservices. I would like to kick off this talk by addressing problems. Problems that are not only relevant to a big software giants, but problems that are also relevant to a medium-sized software house. And we will take a look on how monolithic and microservice application or architecture in general can handle those problems. Then I would like to discuss some of the essential concepts behind microservices, because remember, the goal of this presentation is that we can use this knowledge to start building and writing our own applications. And as you know, each and everything have its own plus and minus, so does the microservice architecture, and we will take a look on a few of the pros and cons. And finally, the part which I love the most, we will squeeze all the theory that we discuss in this presentation into a demo application. Obviously, we will piggyback on Spring Boot, Spring Cloud, and Netflix OSS. A short info about me: I'm a senior software developer currently working for a company called 4Finance IT. Also, I'm a consultant and architect basically around JVM and related technology. A small remark, in theory, it is possible to build, or I should rather emphasize that it's possible to build beautiful monolithic applications. But in general, the monolithic application that we encounter in day-to-day life had a good vision, but the packaging and the end product was not so pretty. That's why most of the time the monolithic application that we encounter looks something like this. It's not written in any holy book that monolithic application should look something like this, but usually we encounter something like this. So what are the problems? Complexity. Complexity can come in many flavors. It can come due to the new user stories, business requirements, competitive advantage. You want to integrate some machine learning and stuff like this. You name them. But the problem is that complexity is not this nice guy which come to your door and knock and say, hey, could you please let me in? Complexity just comes, bash your door into half, and if you are hiding your face under the pillow, it will still find you. And if you try to hide yourself under the bed, it is still going to find you. So the point that I'm trying to make is that we as a developer have to face the complexity. We cannot kind of say, okay, we are done with it. The interesting thing is that in monolithic application, this complexity hits you directly on the face. So due to this, when we want to board new developers, or even we want to move existing programmers and want to increase productivity, it doesn't go hand in hand. Why? Because a new developer has to install a whole set of tools, libraries, application server, database, have to go through a big README file and then Google the instruction, find something that is specific to his operating system, and God knows what not. And although at the end of the day, his and her task was just to add a simple button in a GUI. Just imagine how insane it is, and we call ourselves at the end of the day engineers. In microservice architecture, this complexity is not disappearing. It's not like that microservice just somehow, removed this complexity. The complexity is still there, but it is moved to another layer, interaction layer or distributed system. With time, things become old. So does our system. So in order to support the new user expectations or business need, we need to upgrade our legacy components. Well, upgrading a legacy component is quite tough in monolithic world because of layered architecture and long-term commitment to a tech stack. In microservice, on the other hand side, we can always replace an old microservice with a new one as long as it fulfills its SLA which is service level agreement, and we don't break our APIs. Since monolithic architecture requires long-term commitment to a tech stack, and it's hard to rewrite full or even significant part of the application just to upgrade a new tech stack, so what programmers usually end up is they end up doing a lot of work around. So they bake those functionality, those features which they cannot integrate because of long-term commitment to tech stack, they try to create it by their own. Whereas in microservice world, the picture is not so much bleaky. Why? Because if you have a need to build a microservice using particular tech stack, you can use it. Because microservice architecture don't impose such things like make long-term commitment with a particular tech stack. I'm not saying that each and every microservice should be written in a separate tech stack, but it's possible. If this is the goal, that you can finish your business requirements as fast as possible using some cool new technology, go ahead. When we speak about monolithic application, what we meant is multiple responsibilities. So monolithic applications are built around multiple responsibility, which makes it hard to figure out where a new functionality belongs to. So when a new functionality pops up, it's hard to figure out exactly which part is going to handle this functionality. Whereas when we speak about microservices, we speak about single responsibility principle. Or in general, we can say that microservices are built around single responsibility principle. Hence, when a new functionality pops up, it's easy to figure out which part of the or which component can handle those functionality, or should we create a new component. In terms of standards, it's easy to maintain standards in monolithic because we have one big monolithic application. But on the other hand side, it's hard to maintain the code quality. Why? Because there are too much code going in a one application, so it's hard to kind of figure out or have this clean wall that separates the good and the ugly part. On the other hand side, in microservices, each team is responsible for a particular microservice. Hence, it's easier to maintain the quality, but it's hard to maintain the standards because we have large number of small teams. I'm not saying it's impossible to maintain standards, but it requires some additional work to make sure that each and every team is following those standards. Refactoring. We all love to refactor and throw the code and at the end of the day go home and still our application works in a one piece. When we want to refactor a monolithic application, we start with something like this. But usually we end up with something like this. Why? Because even unintentionally we have to touch those part of the systems which we even haven't thought about. Why? Because everything is glued so tightly together. In microservices, when we want to refactor, we even don't have to think or bother about the full microservice world. We don't have to think about the hundreds of small components that are, integrating as a one application and making our fulfilling our business needs. When we have to refactor a microservice, we are confined to a particular microservice, and as long as we are not going to break our agreements or API to the outer world, we are free to refactor, so we don't have to think about hundreds of moving parts. Okay, so let's now discuss what microservices are. Well, it's a way of creating application in which the full application consists of small components, and those components talk to each other via language agnostic API. The word micro is quite nicely defined in physics. I still remember from my school age, the days when we were learning physics, micro was defined like 10 to the power minus 6. Until today, it is defined like this. And it's simple. If someone asks you what micro is, 10 to the power minus 6. And if you go 10 to the power minus 9 or 10 to the power minus 3, the semantics of the word change. Whereas in microservices, in IT world, micro means something small and service means service, so something small. But something small for me can be big for you and vice versa. So some people have these misconceptions like if we have like 100 lines of code, it's a microservice, or if we have 4 methods, it's a microservice. Well, I would say that it is not the goal I mean, okay, if your business has such a need to write four methods, go ahead and go home and enjoy and party. Micro means, in this case, more about each and every component. So each and every component should do one thing, and it should do one thing nicely. That's the word micro signifies here. So don't think it in terms of like 80 lines of code, 50 lines of code. It is rather about each and every individual component. Okay, so now we understand what microservices are. What are the core concepts which helps us to get started with microservices? First is service registry. Have any one of you heard about service registry? Okay, so just to explain it in a plain English, let's imagine that we have two services, service A and service B. And let's say service A wants to communicate with service B. And let's assume that the communication is a vanilla communication, so we don't have load balancer or proxy and stuff like this. So what service A need is, service A need to know the IP address and the port on which service B is running, and then it can communicate. But now let's imagine that service A and service B are microservices. And as soon as we step into the microservice world, our dreams are shattered, you know. Why so? Because one of the key strengths of microservices is scale on demand. And scale on demand means that whenever we need to scale a particular microservice, we can scale it without scaling the full application. But in order to fulfill such a promise, usually we end up deploying our microservices on an infrastructure which provides no guarantee that next time when we will launch our microservice, it will be running on a particular port. You may ask a question, well, what type of infrastructure it is which provides no guarantee and still we use it? For instance, cloud. On cloud, you have no guarantee that next time when you fire your microservice, it will be running on the same port. And IP, for example, the cloud provider is free to choose, assign the dynamic IP to your services. So hence, we need a single source of truth, a place where we can go and ask questions like, hey, do you know the address of service B? Can you tell me how many instances of service B are there up and running? Can you tell me whether service B is even alive right now, or how many instances of service B are there? And this single source of truth is called service registry. There are many flavors of service registry, but for the sake of this talk, I have confined myself to these three flavors. And when you are building microservices, which one you should use? I mean, do you like the logo of Zookeeper, so use Zookeeper, or, you know, to someone, this Netflix looks nicer? Well, it again depends the question on your infrastructure. So let's say if you are deploying your microservices on an infrastructure where you don't really care about network partitioning and zone-based partitioning, then Zookeeper is a good choice. Why? Because it is consistent and partitioned. But if you are deploying your microservices on an infrastructure where factors like network partitioning and zone-based partitioning comes handy, so these are the things which will occur quite frequently, then Eureka is a good choice. Why? Because then the consistency is not so important, but availability is. And the last is console. It's also AP, which means available and partition. It's really nice. I like console quite a lot. It provides lots of nice and cool features. But for this talk, we are going to concentrate on Eureka. So Eureka is an open source service registry discovery, you can call it, built by Netflix. It's open source. It consists of two components, server and client. In order to understand how this component works, let's try to understand the communication between a client and a server. So the first thing the client should do is it should register. And he does the registration by sending an initial heartbeat, which happens after 30 seconds. And once the client is registered, he has to constantly tell to the server, hey, I'm alive, I'm alive. He does so by sending a heartbeat after every 30 seconds. What happens if the server doesn't receive a heartbeat? Well, in this case, the server waits for something like 90 seconds, and then he assumes that the client is dead and he removes the client. But let's assume our client is healthy and he's, you know, sending the heartbeat after every 30 seconds. The next thing which client should do is he should fetch the registry. The registry is the contains the information that the client used to find the other services. And remember, the world, it cache it locally. So we know when something is cached, we have to update the cache periodically. And the client does the update after every 30 seconds. So he asks the server to send the new updates. But it's worth to remember that he don't ask for the new info all the time in sense of from the beginning. He just asks for the delta. And delta means the difference between the last fast cycle and the current one. So this info is really small. And lastly, when a client wants to shut down, he sends a cancellation request on shutdown, and the server just removes the instance from registry. Are there any questions till yet? No. Okay, so let's take a look on second concept. So as we remember that a client in microservice world can have multiple options to talk to. So let's say I'm a client and I want to communicate with service B. The server will say, hey, you have 10 instances to talk to. So which one of them should I contact? Should I contact the first one, the last one, the middle one? Believe me or not, in enterprise world, this type of questions makes the difference between a smoother user experience and the cost which you end up paying to a cloud provider. Fortunately, Netflix have provided us something called Ribbon. It's an open source client-side load balancer. It provides quite nice features. For instance, zone affinity. And if you set this enable, then the load balancer will only return the server that are in the same zone. And we can reduce the cost of cross-zone traffic, so we don't make a client from one zone to talk to another zone. Thus, the client can have faster response time, so we can also speed up the response time. It also have capability to handle the failures. So for example, it can find out dynamically which of the servers are alive. So let's say if there are 10 servers he got and 3 of them are already dead. So he's not going to even talk to them or direct any traffic. It can even further filter the servers based on metrics, which is generated by Hystrix. And I'm going to show how the Hystrix looks like. By default, we support the Ribbon supports round robin, but it's easy to implement your own load balancing rules using rule-based load balancing. The third concept that is quite important is edge service or gateway. I think till now, all of you will agree that it's not quite intelligent idea to expose directly the address of microservice to the client because this info can change. But let's imagine that you have to, for example, enable the authentication. So all the API calls that are coming from a client you want to authenticate. Or you want to do a dynamic routing. So you want to dynamically route the request. Or maybe you want to start monitoring all the API calls for some reason. So in order to handle such things in the distributed world, we need a edge service or a proxy gateway. And Zuul is, again, Netflix have provided us with Zuul. What Zuul is, internally, it consists of pre-routing and post. They are filters. And if anything goes wrong in any of this stage, it goes and asks to the error filter. In order to understand how Zuul works, let me demonstrate you how a request flows through the Zuul. So let's say a client make a HTTP request. The request comes to the Zuul, and first it is handled by the pre-stage or pre-filters. You can have n number of them. What you can do in pre-stage, you can do stuff like authentication, for instance. So you can authenticate. Then the request is moved to a routing stage. In routing stage, you can do stuff like where you want to route the request, whether you want a dynamic routing or not. But once the request is routed and the response is back, the request is further handled by the post filters. In post stage, you can do stuff like add the default HTTP headers, for instance, or expose some data to the matrix. And I will show you an example how we can collect this data of matrix to monitor our production environment at the end of this conference. And finally, the response is given back to the client. So this is how a request flows through the Zuul. But apart from these simple filters, I mean, we can write our own HTTP filters and do this stuff. Why do we need Zuul? Does it provide some nice features? A few of the features that are quite nice in Zuul is are the following. Load shedding. So in plain English, it means we can allocate capacity for each type of request. And if some of the request goes over the limit, then we can say the Zuul that, okay, drop those requests. Authentication goes well with Zuul. It knows how to handle them, how to pass the token and stuff like this. We can also have static response handling. So sometimes we don't want the request to go through an internal cluster. We want to return the response directly at the edge service. This is the feature which I like the most, surgical debug filter. So let's imagine you have a client and only one client have problem accessing your production environment. So when he's making a call, something is going wrong and you want to debug your production. Well, you can extend the surgical debug filter and then all the requests that are made by that particular client, you will be able to intercept and see what's going on. Things becomes quite interesting when you can use the same concept in debugging zones. So let's say you have servers allocated in east zone and west zone, and let's say for some reason east zone cluster is not working properly and you want to debug it, you can use the same concept. And finally, let's say that we are programmers, we have created our build and we want to deploy this build, but you know, deployment production is fun but not so much fun when you are running massive services, because you know a small delay or bad user experience can end you, cost you a lot depending on your business model. So what you can do is you can gradually increase the traffic. So let's say I have a production build and I can say Zuul, okay, let increase traffic by 5%, and then I can, you know, gather the data how my build performed. Then I can say increase by 10%, 15%, 20%, go on and on and on. And let's say after 75%, I observe that my build is taking too long to reply for a particular request. I can just tell to the guys that, okay, the build is not good enough. So these are some of the features that comes handy when we are using Zuul. So it's not only like you have pre, post, and route stages and, you know, the request goes through a filters. The last concept, which is quite important to understand, is failure management. Well, in monolithic application, we have one application and it's easy to manage it. But when we have hundreds of moving parts, we have 101 problems, you know, because we have now to manage all those parts. And in distributed world, we can have all sort of failures, starting from latency. We can have the service which we are invoking is already dead. And we can even cascade those failures further on if we don't handle them properly. So in order to handle the errors properly, or in a nutshell, if you don't want to go to the boss and say, hey, it's the fault of this service or this API which I'm talking to because this server was down and our production is blown up and don't fire me for this, you should use Hystrix. You should think about managing failures. So let's take a look about on some of the plus and minus. Well, first of all, we are speaking about component. We don't have a one big monolithic application to handle. We have small components. Thanks to this, we have also richer component tech stack. We can use the particular technology to build a particular microservice. Scalability comes quite good in terms of microservices. We don't have to scale full application. We can just scale a particular part of the application. And finally, we can have also resilience, which means that if one part of my system is blown, I don't have to blow up my full production. But what is the price behind all these nice things that are provided by microservices? So first of all, now we are in distributed domain. So now we don't have one single system to manage. We have hundreds of moving parts to manage. And we need lots and lots of arsenal of tools in order to manage the infrastructure. It means that if your company can't embrace the DevOps culture and small teams, microservice is not going to be quite useful in your business domain. Testing and transactions are something that we take for granted when we speak about monolithics. But in microservices, we have to think about stuff like mutual consistency or eventual consistency versus ACID compliant. And testing is also. Okay, now let me show you a demo because we have 15 minutes or so. So the demo, I'm going to use Spring Cloud, and the tweet from Phil have, I think, nailed why we need Spring Cloud. So I mean, the thing that I'm going to show, you can just, you know, use the plain old Java and write, you know, new classes and everything and be happy that I created this stuff. No one stop you for this. But if we like Spring, we like dependency injection, and we want to embrace the open source, we can follow the Spring Cloud. So here is a Spring, here is Spring Boot, and there on the right is Spring Cloud. So Spring Cloud kind of encapsulates for us the nice patterns and Netflix stack and provide it out of the box, so you are ready to go. What is a demo application looks like? So we have a catalog service. A catalog service is a microservice that will demonstrate how a microservice or what type of patterns we should use when a microservice have to talk to some third-party system or even other microservices. And product, price, and comment service will illustrate that how we can create microservices that don't need to communicate with other services for some reason. Okay, so now let me show you the code. Okay, so the first thing that we need to build is a Eureka. So you remember the client and the server? Yes? I mean, come on, yes or no, or are you asleep or what?
Yes.
Okay, or maybe you are shy that we are recording and you don't want your voice to be recognized and searched by Google. Okay, jokes apart. So the first thing we need is Eureka server. The server which can register plays the role of the server to which the client can register. How do we do it? So this is a normal Spring Boot application. I have annotated it with Spring Boot application. And I say add enable Eureka server, and that's it. Behind the scene, Spring is going to configure a Eureka server with defaults for me and fire it on 8761 pole. Obviously, we can override the defaults by creating an application.yml file, and we are good to go. The next thing now we can concentrate is how to create our services that don't need to talk to others. So first thing that you will notice is that I have annotated it with add enable discovery client. And what it is going to do, this annotation is enough for the Eureka server to find and register this service. So now my client and server registration is done. What I can do now, I can start writing some of the code for which the company pays me money. So here is a comment service. As you see, it consists of only one method, but as I said, it is only for a demo purpose. In real life, you will have more than one method. And it is a REST controller, nothing fancy here. It listens for the request coming on a URL comment. And what it does is, for a given product ID, it simulates generation of comments. In real life, you can fetch those comments from database or process them by some machine learning solution, stuff like this. Just to show you that price and product service looks the same, and to be 100% sure that I have nothing covered, under my sleeves. So the price service looks exactly the same in terms of that it have to register by at enable discovery client, and it just return some price. So for a given product ID, it simulates some price generation. Are there any questions? Everyone is following me. Yeah?
Why do you use SMF4J? What's the annotation
for? Okay, so this is used for here. You see, so I have a log.debug. I can, if I want debug something, I have annotated with @SLF4J. It's just a way I'm lazy to type too much code. Okay. So now let's draw our attention to our service, which do need to talk with other services. So as you see, we have a catalog service, but this time it is annotated with @enableHystrix. So these two things you know, hopefully. But why do we need Hystrix here? So as I told, that this service have to talk with other service, and it will be my problem if I don't handle situations like those services are down or they are taking too long to reply. So in order to handle the failures, I need Hystrix here. And now take a look on catalog service. So as we see, for a given product ID, I'm creating a catalog. And how a catalog is created? Well, it's a simple POJO, nothing fancy here. So I have an ID and a product, and I just, you know, have a simple constructor here. But let's go back. What I do in catalog is I fetch the product, comments, and price. So how the fetching of product looks like. So I have a class called product builder, and I am using REST template. Have any one of you used REST template or know what REST template is provided by Spring? Okay, so just to make it clear for each and everyone who is present here, when we want to make a REST call to other systems or other API, we can use some HTTP client and do everything nicely by our own, or we can use REST template provided by Spring, which have method like get for object, and we provide a particular URL and the class to which the response should be mapped. And that's there. That's all what you should know about REST template. But you remember the ribbon, our nice friend who have to play the role of load balancing. How do I inject this in Spring? Well, I have an annotation @loadBalanced. And if I say that @loadBalanced in front of REST template, here I'm doing a constructor injection, as you see. Spring will configure for me the ribbon, and my REST template is ready to go. So now my third part is done. And then as you can see, when I'm fetching a product, I'm saying, okay, get for object, use this URL, and map the response. But as you notice, there is something going on here. I have a method annotated with @Hystrix command. So what it means is that when we have enabled the Hystrix, out of the box, it is not going to do a lot for me. I have to use it wisely. It's like my money. If someone gives you money, you have to spend it wisely. Yeah. So here I say to Hystrix that, okay, if something goes wrong here in this place, then use this method as a fallback. It is not a must. You don't have to provide each and every time the fallback, but it's nice to have if you can make some default fallbacks method. For instance, here I'm fetching a comment. So if there is any problem fetching the comments, I can return always an empty array of comments. So the user will just see some empty list or no comments on a GUI. The last thing is how these URLs are getting resolved. So these URLs can get resolved by Zuul, our final part of the puzzle. So in order to enable the Zuul, I just annotate a class with @enableZuulProxy. And you guys will ask, okay, you enable the Zuul proxy, but how the hell those paths are getting resolved? So you can create an application.yml file here. And here you can see I am saying, okay, I want these type of routes, and I want these type of paths. And that's it. So now, let me show you how this full application works.
Okay, I have to exit the full screen.
Exit presentation mode, not exit full screen.
Oh, thanks. Okay, but it doesn't matter. We can always click like this. Okay, so first thing is, I have all my services up and running. So I have all of my services up and running here. As you can see, this is a GUI which is provided by Spring Boot. It is out of the box. It's not that I have coded it. But the same info is accessible by curl. As you can see, this info don't make a lot of sense here. But if we can just parse this information. So for example, here, if I, not here. Okay, here. So if I try to parse this same information, you can see that I have name of the service, the port on which the service is running, and how many, what is the IP here. And all this info is provided to me. Let me now make a request here. So I can make a request to localhost 8765. And you see that I got here some price, some products and some comment, yeah? Okay, and here, I think I will be good enough if I exit presentation mode, yeah? Okay, but now let's do something more nicer. You remember this Hystrix, so when I make here a request, you see that I have some matrices here. I can obviously solve them with alphabet. And you see that my circuit is open and I have no problems. But let's now try to do something more crazy, something that happens, can happen more practically, because in real life production, things never go smooth always. There are some problems. So let's try to do something. For instance, let's try to kill the comment service. So I have here comment service up and running, and I can kill this. So what do you guys think is going to happen right now? Does my full application is going to be blown, or I will survive somehow with some magic, or nothing is going to work? What do you think? Okay, so someone is watching code. Okay, so just to be sure, I can go here on localhost. If I refresh here, you see I don't have, no longer have comment service, so it is deregistered. And if I make here a request, okay, something is broken. No, nothing is broken, so I think it was more kind of empty things, because I was launching to a different URL. So here you can see I have empty comments here. And let me try to show you how Hystrix is going to come handy. So let's say now I'm going to make 100 requests to the catalog service and try to have your eyes here. Sorry for this, I don't have nice display here. You see I make 100 requests, and what happened here is 67 of them are short circuit and 33 of them have red status. Let me show you something once again. So I make 100 requests here, and you see I have only one here and 99 short circuit. What it means in reality is that Hystrix have allowed only one request to the comment service. It check it is down, and the remaining 99 requests, it just short circuit. Short circuit means it is even not going to ask comment service whether it can give me comment. And this is called the failure, managing failures.
The last thing that I want to show you is we can run the same application in Docker. Is anyone here who have heard about Docker, or everyone knows what Docker is? Oh, great. I have a great audience. So I don't have to go through and explain most of the things. So you can check out the URL where I have Docker up and running. Yes. Okay. And here we are. Okay. This is the last thing which I want to show you, which is called Zipkin. And what Zipkin is, in reality, it is a distributed tracing library. So when you have hundreds of small components, you want to visualize that how the request flows through the system. It is created by Twitter, based on a paper by Google, and it is open source. And here you can see that my request flowed something like this. I can click here and see if my resolution is good enough here. I have Zuul service, catalog service, and then the second stage of my request was looking something like this. So I had a product service here, and then I made some other calls here. As you can see, for product service, I can zoom in here. I can zoom in here and see how much time it took. Why it took a bit more time here? Because only I have added thread.sleep to demonstrate that if some service take a bit more time, it can track. You can track the time quite precisely. Okay, so that was the demo. Microservices in real life doesn't look only about four parts. There are lots and lots of tools that you have to use. These are some of the tools that we have used in production. And next are the matrices. So here, do you guys see those green arrows on the top? Yeah, so those green arrows are the matrix. So whenever we deploy a new build on our production, we want to visualize it, because we can deploy practically at an insane rate with microservices. So we want to register like how my matrices are, how the health of the application is, and so on and so forth. Here I have a thread pool, here I have DB connection, the memories, but this part on the right, order process, is quite interesting. So since our business don't pay us money to just, you know, generate stats about, you know, the DBs and all this stuff, business is really interested in how many things we have sold. So we have gathered our own matrices which show us that how many orders are processed every second, and how many of them were above, let's say, 2,000 euro or 20,000 euro. So for business, it's quite nice to have such information. Thanks for your attention. If you have any questions, you can go ahead and ask. Okay.
Yeah. What's your experience with dependencies between microservices? So, for example, if the requirements changes or you are adding a new feature and you have to change two services at the time, what does it mean for deployment?
Okay, so so for all of those who, because this is recording, so I will just repeat the question. So the question is, how do we handle like changes when they come to the microservices, and if we have a need to edit more than two services or three? So it depends, again, the like many questions and the answers, it depends. If you have to change the API, we follow semantic versioning. So we have like, you can have a minor change, a major change in the API. And if you have, you can create another version of the API, make both of them up and running, and slowly upgrade each and every component, and leave the existing system working. Do not break, and if you think it's stable enough, just delete the box. And okay, other questions? Yeah?
Did you use Zipkin with message queuing as well?
Pardon?
I saw that you were having an example with Rabbit, and your example there was reference to Rabbit and queue.
Ah.
Did you use it in with message queuing to see?
Okay. So the question is that do we use? First of all, I had Rabbit MQ in my demo. So the question is that do we use Zipkin with RabbitMQ? So first of all, two questions. RabbitMQ was not used for Zipkin here. RabbitMQ was used rather as part of another thing which I have in my demo to send the logs and stuff like this to Turbin. We don't use Zipkin with RabbitMQ because we don't use messaging so much. If you have more questions, please find me outside because I think next talk is going to start here. So thanks a lot, guys.